Ascent TV is proud to present Hajj Lectures presented by Samahat al-Sheikh Safdar Radi.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi al-tayyibin al-tahirin wa al-la'natu al-da'ima al-abadiyya ala a'da'ihim ajma'in ila qiyam yawmiddin. Inshallah, today we are going to talk about the laws which are some practical laws. There are so many laws regarding the ihram, but we are going to talk about those laws which are really, many people, they fall into these mistakes and errors. Common mistakes and common errors. Some of them, they might not be common errors, but we might just mention it. But most of the laws we will try to cover and emphasize on them are common mistakes and common errors people they make. A mahram person can cut the nails of another person, even if that person was mahram too. So when we talk about cutting the nail, one cannot cut the nails of himself, but he can cut the nails of other person. So the evidence indicates that a person should not cut his own nails. That means if he cuts somebody else's nails, then there shouldn't be a problem, even if that person was mahram. Number two, injection or poking a needle or donating blood should be avoided unless if it was necessary to do so. Because remember the bleeding issue. Bleeding is one of the things which is forbidden. So if somebody pokes himself with a needle, he will bleed. So if it was not necessary, don't poke and don't inject. So number three, the minimum part required in the issue of shade is that the head and the chest should be exposed to the sun. If the lower body is shaded by the sides, then there is no harm. Here we mentioned that, remember the tadlil issue, that traveling under the roofless bus. Suppose if people, they were traveling in this roofless bus. Now the roofless bus, what's the problem with roofless bus? Roofless bus doesn't have roof, but the bus, they have sides. Now for those who are following Sayyid Abul Qasim Al-Khu'i, they, like this is the chair of the bus. They cannot sit on the chair because the sides are covered. Remember the wind issue? So he is not exposed to the air. So for them, they have to sit on the back of the seat, above the back part of the chair, upper part of the chair. So why? Because when they are sitting upper part, most of their body is now exposed to the air. But when they are sitting down, they are covered by the sides of the bus because it's roofless bus. So when they sit up, that means their lower part is under the shade, which is accepted. But the upper part, the chest and the head, is exposed in the air or under the sun. For all those other maraja who say that sun is a problem only, for them, these roofless buses are okay. Because the minimum part required in the issue of shade is that the head and the chest should be exposed to the sun. The head and the chest. As long as the head and the chest are exposed to the sun, then if the lower body is shaded by the side shades, then there is no harm in it. A mahram should not shade himself from the sun and rain. This is Sayyid Sistani's opinion regarding the rain. He adds the rain with the sun. If there is no sun or rain, then he can travel under shaded means, like at night. If it was night, there was no rain, then he can travel under shaded. He can travel in these airplanes, which are, of course, we cannot have a roofless airplane. Maybe there are, God knows better. But anyhow, penalty of shading is one per ihram only. We mentioned there's a goat. If somebody shades himself, then this is one of the things which there's a goat or a sheep. But the sin will repeat by repeating it purposely. Suppose if somebody repeats traveling under the shaded areas, there are two things. One goat per ihram. You said, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, from here to taqsir, unlocking your ihram, it's one goat. Even though if you travel from one bus to another bus, from one plane to from plane to bus, all these kind of things, still there will be one goat only. Why? Or one sheep only. One sheep is per ihram. But the sin continues. The sin continues. For example, you arrived, you were able to take night flight. You intentionally took day flight. So now you have a sin. Besides, you have to pay the penalty, kafara. Now, when you arrived at Jeddah airport, there were two types of buses. You arrived in day, roofless buses and roof buses. You took bus with roof, air-conditioned bus. You were able to take roofless bus, but you took air-conditioned bus. In this case, what happens? If you take roofless bus, you are okay. But still you have to pay penalty because you took the airplane. You took the airplane in the day. You were able to take it at night. You took the airplane in the day. So you have to pay penalty. But here, if you take roofless bus, there's no sin on you. So what if you say, I already have to pay one sheep. So let me continue and sit in an air-conditioned bus and enjoy and relax. Here, if you sit in air-conditioned bus, it's correct. You will not have any other penalty. Though you will not have any other penalty, but still it's a sin. If you have an option to go into roofless bus, travel into roofless bus from Jeddah to Mecca, then go, choose that. If not, then what can we do? If the roofless, if the air-conditioned bus is only the bus available there, then you will not have to pay any penalty and there's no istighfar. Because you already are going to pay one penalty, that's it. So if you repeat going under shaded means being shaded, then you are going to repeat the sin intentionally, but the penalty is going to be one. But suppose if you're compelled to go, there was no other flight, or the flights were at night were very expensive, unaffordable. So you go by day flight, and you are compelled here. You don't have a good option here. So, but there won't be any sin. You still will have to pay one penalty. You still will have to pay one goat or a sheep, but no sin on you. And if you arrived in Jeddah airport, there was no other bus than the air-conditioned bus, then you don't have any other option. So penalty of shading is one per ihram only. But the sin will repeat by repeating it purposely. The prohibited shading for men is while traveling or transporting from city to city, and on the basis of obligatory precaution inside the cities too, such as transporting inside Mecca. This is an obligatory precaution because some maraja say once you arrive in Mecca, you keep your stuff, you settle down, then inside Mecca, inside Mina, you can travel in shaded means. There's no problem in it. But Sayyidi Sistani says, no. On the basis of obligatory precaution, it is still considered shading traveling because it's not necessary traveling from city to city, even inside Makkah, transportation. For Sayyidi Sistani, is the transportation and not traveling. So inside Makkah, you're not traveling. Come on, you're not traveling from your hotel to you're commuting, you're transporting. That's a transportation. So the transportation is not traveling. He said any transportation which is in the shaded area should be avoided based on the obligatory precaution. Of course, from city to city, it's fatwa. You should not. In this case, suppose if you are following Sayyidi Sistani and you are Muhrim and you are traveling from Mecca, inside Mecca or inside Mina from the Rami, from the pelting the shaitan to the slaughtering area, then you can refer to another marja who says as long as you are in the same city, you don't need to avoid the shading vehicles or shading cars or shading buses as long as if you are transporting inside the city. So you can refer to another marja who says transporting inside the cities does not require from a person to avoid the shading means of transportation. It's just from city to city. So again, let me make it clear. From Mina to Arafat, Mina to Muzdalifa, Muzdalifa to Arafat, all these things, or Mecca to one of these three places. If you are transporting from city to city or place to place or station to station, then this is considered a journey or a travel. In this case, you cannot have this. You cannot travel under a shaded bus or means of transportation. This is general fatwa. Sayyidi Sistani has a precaution. Even inside the city, you cannot do that. Here, if he follows Sayyidi Sistani, it's troubling him, all this kind of situation, to try to find an open truck to go from haram to hotel while he's in a haram. In this case, he can refer to another mujtahid. He permits him to transport from inside the city from place to place without any requirement of having an open or roofless truck or roofless car or whatever. Number 7, relying on the back portion of the seat is not considered shading. Like we said, chest and face. So I'm now sitting, my back is covered. Is my covering my back, is it considered shading? No. He says, relying on the back portion of the seat is not considered shading. The shading from the rain is an obligatory precaution in the opinion of Sayyidi Sistani. So Sayyidi Sistani says, based on the obligatory precaution, if you are traveling at night, and the rain falls, on the basis of obligatory precaution, pay penalty. But as we mentioned, this opinion is the opinion of Sayyidi Sistani, as it is an obligatory precaution. So if, suppose if you don't want to pay penalty and it's raining, so you just can refer to another mujtahid, you know, another Ayatollah al-Uzma who is after Sayyidi Sistani to avoid paying the penalty on raining, because it's an obligatory precaution. If a mahram woman wants to cover her face from foreign men, then she can cover it by keeping the veil away from her face by the use of a baseball cap, for example, in a way that the veil is away and does not touch her face. So it's not considered cover. We said covering is covering the face. You put something on the face. Veil is preventing someone from looking at your face. So veil is like putting a baseball cap and putting it away from the face. That is like not covering the face, but yet preventing yourself from anybody looking at you. Number 10, she can cover her face while sleeping or an extra part of it in Salat. Like for in Salat, women, they need to cover their body, hair and everything. So they cover a little bit extra portion. In a way, they keep like the portion of sujood and they cover. They cannot allow their hair to come out while they are in Salat. So she can cover her face while sleeping or an extra part. Like she's muhrim and she's offering her Salat. We'll tell her, if you are muhrim and if you are offering your Salat, then you can cover a little bit of your face from the chin, you know, because if chin is covered, then it's part of the face. If this head is covered a little bit down, that's a part of the face. If for Salat, it's okay. Accidental covering of the face is not problematic for women. You know, women, they are like sometimes in the crowd, what happens? Somebody accidentally touches the woman, you know. So there was a woman sitting beside a woman, and this lady was standing up and accidentally she hit her back or her face, or accidentally things happened. So the face of that woman was sitting beside her was covered. If accidental covering of the face is not problematic. 12. The head and the ears of mahram men should not be covered. However, there's a problem in strapping the head with a strap from the forehead to the back. Like for example, head and the ears. They should not wear something which covers the head and the ear. So no cap, no amama, no nothing. Whatever covered, no qutra, no shafiya, no nothing, no shawls, nothing. Nothing on the head and the ears. It should be exposed. This head and the ear should be exposed. Strap. Many times people, they put strap here. Is it considered covering the head? Don't, as long as it does not, like don't cover your ear with the strap. No. So there is no problem in strapping the head with a strap from forehead to the back. But so when you are putting the strap, isn't this covering your head from behind? Yes, it's covering your head from behind. There's no problem in it. There is no problem in it. Covering the head and the ear. So even if the strap goes like this, as long as it's not covering the ear, there's no problem in it. Head of a muhrim can be covered by the hand or any part of his body. Hand or any part of his body. People like, for example, sometimes they want to, their son, they can cover their head with the hand or any part of the body. Like they can cover their head with the side, as long as it's not a cloth. Many times, you know, you will see the youth, they will go and have a shower after they're exhausted, sweat and all these kind of things. Once they arrive in Mina, they just go into this shower room or restroom and they just have a nice cool shower, removing their filth. And what happens when they're coming out, they have this towel. They wrap their towel on the head as like coming out from the restroom or from their home. And, oh, don't cover your head. Why are you covering your head? It's haram to cover your head. What's going on? You know, so they quickly remove the towel from the head. But of course, we mentioned this is unintentionally. I mean, somebody forgot that he should not cover his head. So unintentionally, there's no problem, as we mentioned before. So the head of a mahram can be covered by the hand or any part of his body. Only like that, not with any other cover. Muhrim men and women should not totally immerse their head under the body. Immersing the head or the body in the water, underneath the water, it is one of the prohibited things in the status of ihram. So they can have a shower, but they cannot dip themselves underneath the water, especially their head. There is no penalty in covering the head due to the necessity. Suppose if there was sun. Many times in Hajj, the sun is so strong, and there are elders with us. So what can we do? I mean, these elders, they need some special care. So we tell them you can cover your head. The elders, you can cover your head. There is no problem in it. There is no penalty in covering the head due to a necessity. If for some reason uncovering the head of a muhrim man was causing an unbearable embarrassment for him, then he can cover without any penalty. Suppose we said for necessity you can cover. For necessity we mentioned there is no penalty in covering the head to a necessity. Health issues, medical issues. Sometimes, you know, in Hajj everything is exposed. Even the head. People, they will try to cover their head with wigs, artificial hair, with the amama, with caps, with baseball caps, with whatever. In Hajj, everything is exposed. Many times people, they're embarrassed of showing their head. If there's some. So many people, they're bald. You know, they didn't get used to being bald. They get embarrassed from showing their baldness. The problem here is sometimes people, they have weird things in their head. I mean, I have seen it. Why? Some of the youth we saw, there were marks of like strange, weird marks on their head. We asked them, what's this? They said when he was a child, you know, his father threw a key on his head and it stuck in his head and they had to go do some surgery and all those kind of things. Come on, what kind of father is this? And is he playing dart game on his son's head or what? What's going on here? So anyhow, the people, the kids, they go through experience and their heads, they have like history of their childhood. You know, falling down, bumping. Some of them, they have some weird types of bumps in their head, you know, which might be a little bit funny for other people. So sometimes if somebody has some weird things on their head, funny things or mocking things or things which people might mock on them or might laugh, and he feels embarrassment, and that embarrassment was intolerable, that case he can cover his head and without penalty. So if for some reason uncovering the head of a muhrim man was causing an unbearable embarrassment for him, then he can cover without any penalty. A person can sleep on a pillow. When you sleep on a pillow, your head is covered by the pillow. There is no problem. But after taking a shower, he must wipe his head gradually with the towel. So you can sleep on the pillow. But when you come out, when you are taking a shower, you took a shower, what happens? Many times people, they'll come and they'll put the towel up their head like they're in their home. No. You have to do it like this. You take your towel, you just wipe this side, wipe this side, wipe this side. Gradually wipe your head. Gradually, don't bring the whole towel on your head and start rubbing it. No, that's not right. Of course, if you do that intentionally, then we mentioned that there's penalty. So unintentionally, there's nothing. But don't watch out. I mean, try to avoid wiping your head. Wipe it gradually, like from sides. A person can sleep on a pillow, we mentioned. Number 18, a muhrim should not cut or shave his head or hair of anyone else's hair. However, the only exception is if he was doing to unlock his ihram. The only exception is if he was going to unlock his ihram by doing so. And it's obvious. Remember, we mentioned in one of the lessons that when you enter your salat, you enter with takbirat al-ihram. When you say Allahu Akbar, you enter your salat. When you enter your salat, you cannot commit any of those things which are forbidden. One of the forbidden things is talking to the people. Even by saying salam, initiating salam, intentionally, where you are not supposed to say salam in your salat, your salat becomes invalid. So how do we come out from salat? We are inside salat, we are locked. When you say assalamu alaikum, you're talking to the people around you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now you are, so you unlock yourself from salah by something which invalidates, yet Sharia has told us to do so. The same thing, cutting of hair while ihram is forbidden, your hair or other people's hair. So what happens that the only time you have unlocked your ihram, the only time you are allowed to do is when you unlock your ihram. When you unlock your ihram, you are performing something which is forbidden on you. But this is an exceptional case. Sharia told you that once you have done your tawaf, once you have done your salah, your sa'i, once you have done all these things, then you can use this thing which is forbidden, and it's no more forbidden for you in order to come out of ihram. Like assalamu alaikum, in order to come out from salat, you unlock, use some of the things. So we need to be careful. Many times what happened, like... I'm muhrim, I have my scissors with me, handy in my pocket. People, they finish their sa'i between Safa and Marwa, walk between, you start cutting off their hair. Say, I am performing taqsir or cutting my hair to unlock my ihram or to come out of my ihram for the umrah tamattu, hajj tamattu. Say this, I'm telling them the niyyah, and they are saying the niyyah, and I crisp, you cut the hair off. Now, the problem is, did you become muhal? Did you cut off your hair first? Oh my goodness, I forgot. Uh-oh, we have a problem here. Remember the hair issue? Even unintentionally, we have a problem. So what happens here? That a person needs to first unlock himself, then go and unlock others' ihram. So a muhrim should not cut or shave his head or hair of anyone else's hair. However, the only exception is if he was going to unlock his ihram, his own ihram, by doing so. Muhrim should carefully scratch his body to avoid any fall of hair or any bleeding. The care should be taken while performing the wudu. For medical purposes, a person can apply oil or an ointment which does not have any scent or perfume odor in it. However, it is permitted to use perfumed medication if it was necessary. So putting those oils, you know, for medical purposes, remember the rashes, people, they feel that they're going to die from the pain of the rashes which they have. So in this case, they can apply. In this case, they know that they're going to have it. They can apply it preventatively to prevent themselves from going into that problem of rashes. And if it is medical necessity, then perfume medication is permitted. Also, a muhrim woman can wear her regular jewelry as long as there is no aim of beautification. Regular jewelry is the jewelry which the woman is used to wear. Like, for example, many women, they wear, like, the rings. You're used to wear the rings day-to-day life. They wear jewelries at their home. It's a regular thing. They don't have to remove those jewelries. As long as it's not for beautification, it's just they're regularly wearing it. So as long as there is no aim for beautification in wearing those things. Muhrim should not remove his hair from any part of his body and should avoid any act such as scratching the hairy parts of his body in a way that may cause his hair to fall or his body to bleed. Wearing a ring or a watch is permitted if it was not for beautification, but if it was for another valid reason, such as time or keeping the count of tawaf or a recommendation, you know, like, for example, I wear this ring because it's recommended to wear the ring of Aqiq. The stone is very highly recommended. There are so many narrations of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam regarding wearing this ring. So in this case, I'm wearing it qurbatun lillahi ta'ala, to achieve the nearness of Allah. I'm not wearing it to show, see guys, how beautiful my ring is. You know, I'm tough guy. One guy, he had so many rings in his hand. The Shabab, they used to call him Lord of the Rings, you know, because he has so many rings. And each finger, there will be 2-3 rings, you know, like he's selling rings, you know. He's not selling rings. He loves to wear this much rings. That's too extreme also. So like, if you have these rings, you're not wearing it to beautify yourself, to show, there's no problem in it. So it could be a recommendation, or it could be to keep the count of tawaf. For example, many times what happens that like, you finish the first round, you take the ring from this hand, this finger to this finger. Now it's your second round, from this finger to this finger. So you can keep the count of tawaf by the rings, as we mentioned. But sometimes, what if you forgot to remove the ring? That's another issue. Many times it happens. A muhrim should not push or throw or kill crawling insects on his body, such as lice, but gently remove it from his body and keep it somewhere else. We spoke about this also. The forbidden argument is the one which contains the swear, or like the word of oath, or vow words, such as by God or by Allah or similar to it, even if it was in a non-Arabic language. Bakhuda, for example, by God, by Allah, wallahi, any type of language, you know, as long as the forbidden argument is the one which contains the swear. The swear means, the swear has different connotation, but when we say swear, it doesn't mean the bad curse words. We mean by swearing by Allah, like by God. 27. A muhrim can use scentless or odorless soap and shampoo. Yeah, because, you know, most of the shampoos, they have smell, perfume, fragrance. So in order, what happens? I mean, are we going to take shower while we are muhrim? Yes, not just shower. You come from the restroom, your hands are filthy. Come on, I mean, you use number 2 and your hands are greasy or something. You need to wipe that. You must have eaten some greasy food or whatever. You need to wash it with soap. What type of soap? Scentless soap. There are scentless soap. They sell it in Mecca. You know, these soaps are made from olive oil, from regular oils. They don't have any smell. They used to use these soaps for washing the clothes and all these things. Now they have marketed, they have branded. See, Hajj also initiates some marketing incentives. Now they have soap of muhrim, like that. Muhrim, sabun al-muhrim, you know, the muhrim person's soap. This was not in our days. Now we see these kind of brands coming. Does that mean there's no smell in it? That means that. So you, after you use the restroom, you might need to wash your hands, you know, with soap. Or in Mina, when you come back from Arafat or Muzdalifa, your body is filthy. You just want to take a nice shower. You can use this soap. You can use this soap in that shower. No, because you're still muhrim and you're taking shower. No soap with fragrance, no soap with smell. So a muhrim can use scentless or odorless soap or shampoo while he's muhrim. A muhrim can wear stitched shoes or a belt to tighten his lower portion of the ihram attire, but such act is not recommended. So if you have the stitched belt, If you are wearing this belt around your waist or around your navel, if you are wearing it for the situation, what's the type of situation? To keep your money. If your intention is to keep the money, yes. But if your intention is to tighten your lower part of the ihram, no. You cannot tighten your lower part of the ihram with anything. You know, you have to tighten self. You have to get a self grip from the ihram from itself, and you can easily do it. Inshallah, we will explain when we come to our next session how to get a tight grip of ihram. A muhrim can use scentless or odorless soap and shampoo. A muhrim can wear stitched shoes or a belt to tighten his lower portion of the ihram attire, but such act is not recommended. Stitch or shoes or belt to tighten his lower portion of ihram. A muhrim can wear stitched shoes. Shoes you can wear stitched or a belt to tighten his lower portion of the ihram attire, but such is not recommended. There is no harm in the lining stitches or the edges of the ihram attire. Sometimes the ihram has some lining stitches. Those parts, they are okay. The liners, they're okay. As long as the ihram is by itself not stitched. There is no harm in fixing the upper part of the ihram of the man with safety pin. Upper part, you can put safety pins on it as long as the two ends are not tied to each other. Wearing unstitched garments, which are similar to stitched, is prohibited, such as unstitched underwear of a shirt. Like, for example, we said that stitched garments are not allowed. There are people, they now the technology works. They are youth, they want to wear underwear. They said, they ask, can we wear like an underwear which is not stitched, which is like strapped, like you wear like a diaper. You wear like a diaper, you strap it, you know, with the tapes and all, like diaper exactly. Those sticky things, you know. So, no, it's not just stitched cloth. It is stitched cloth or something similar to stitched cloth. You cannot wear it, underwear, nothing. You cannot wear, the man cannot wear except the upper attire, the two towels or two pieces of cloth. Wearing unstitched garments which are similar to stitched is prohibited, such as stitched, unstitched underwear or a shirt. And finally, a sleeping person can cover his body and face without the head while sleeping using stitched blanket. You can use stitched blanket because you're not wearing, it's not considered, I'm wearing a blanket. No, I'm covering myself with a blanket. A muhrim woman cannot wear hand gloves. Hand gloves, no hand gloves for muhrim women. Black eye eyeliner is forbidden on muhrim. Remember the mascara, the eyeliner. A non-black eyeliner is forbidden if it was for the beautification. So black eyeliner is forbidden. Non-black eyeliner is okay if you are not going to beautify yourself, if you are going to wear it for the... put it for the sake of medical purposes or any other. Using perfumed cloth, eating perfumed food, or applying perfume on the body, or even smell perfume voluntarily, except for the perfume of the Kaaba and the perfumed wind blowing in some parts of the Sa'i. When people, they are around the Kaaba, the Holy Kaaba, the cloth of Holy Kaaba, they put perfume on it. That is exceptional case. You can smell that perfume while you are muhrim. While you are between Safa and Marwa, walking between these two mounts of Safa and Marwa, there are doors. And they sell perfume outside. Sometimes the wind blows inside and the perfume smell comes inside the passage of Safa and Marwa, the walkway of Safa and Marwa, and you smell. These two are exceptional cases. Other than that, using perfume cloth. No perfume cloth. Eating perfume food with saffron and all those kind of things, no. Applying perfume on the body, no. Or even smell perfume voluntarily. Like you are going somewhere, walking beside the stores of perfume and you smell, nice smell. No, no, no. As a measure of precaution, a person should hold his breath while eating the fruits which has nice scent, such as an apple. An apple has nice scent. As a matter of precaution, just hold your breath and crunch your apple. If the sandals or slippers or flip-flops are covering the posterior part of the leg, then a muhrim man should cut some of the strap in a way that it does not cover most of it. Like, for example, this is the shoes. You cannot cover, this is the leg. You cannot cover the whole leg. You cannot cover the whole leg. So what happens if you are, you have a shoes which has a strap which is big strap. It's covering most of your leg. You have to make a hole inside it. You have to cut from it a hole so that the leg is appeared. So most of the leg should be appeared. You can cover, you can wear straps. As long as most of the leg is appeared, there's no problem in it. A person should hold his nose while walking through places where he can smell perfume, and should avoid holding his nose while walking in places with foul smells. Yes, he can walk fast. So in this case, what we are trying to say? We are trying to say that if you are walking and you smell like filthy, foul, smell like a skunk passed by, you know, may God bless your heart, you cannot hold your breath. You cannot say, oh, no. No. Just say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Just walk fast, you know. Run away from that skunky area. So in that case, you have to walk fast. So yes, he can walk fast, but you cannot hold your nose. Killing harmful animals such as snakes and scorpions is not considered hunting. Looking into a mirror for beautification is only forbidden. And inshallah, we'll start with manasik al-hajj in our next session. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin.
وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ.
Copy, duplication, distribution and broadcast of this program is strictly prohibited by law without the express written consent of Ascent TV. All rights are reserved to Ascent TV. For more programs like this, visit us online at www.ascenttv.net. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.